Hello everyone and welcome back to Astrox Imperium. This is DEVLOG video number 78 and today we are taking a look at a very special build, build 100. That's right, I've updated the game 100 times and I'd say it's coming along and shaping up nicely and we're starting to get into the good stuff. As these mechanics get wrapped up and polished away, it's making it much easier for me to transition over to the actual content of the storyline and little goodies and missions and things like that. So it's starting to get fun for me a little bit too. All right, before I jump into these goodies that I've got for you here in Build 100, I did want to take a moment and explain some changes that I've made to the sandbox generator. There were some issues with the number of galaxies, so that as you would jack up these sectors up to 500, it would spread out the skills and spread out the missions and all of the little details of each individual sector all the way up to sector 500. So what that would mean is some of those high level skills would just take forever, if not make it nearly impossible on a 500 sector map to find. So what I've done is I've changed the way that the generator works, and now what it's doing is going through those sectors and basically distributing those skills more evenly up to 100 sectors. So regardless of the number of sectors that you select, it's going to pump out the skills and the items, and the levels of those items will distribute up to sector 100. And what that does is gives it much more feel like the campaign mode, but still allows you to increase the overall size of your universe map without making it too difficult and torturous to find some of those high level skills. And the other thing that I did is made sure that as I'm generating those skills, it is keeping a running tally to make sure that if, you know, due to any of the randomness or some of the settings that you've selected, it will not leave skills out of your game. So what it'll do is make sure that as it's dishing out the skills, like cards from a deck, any cards left over after the entire galaxy has been generated, it'll go back through and spit out the rest of those cards and distribute them into the proper stations. So that way there are no games that can generate where you are missing skills completely. All right, so we got that stuff taken care of. Now let's get into the good stuff. So over these past, I'd say a month or so, I've been working on wormholes, and I finally got enough of it together that I'm ready to release it into the game. Now I've been testing this over the past few days. I haven't run into any issues, but it is quite possible that there are some unseen issues that I have not yet touched. And I would say if you run into anything like that, make sure you contact me immediately and I will hot fix it, because I don't want anything happening with save games or breaking anything in your save game. So basically, there are a few things that we need to take a look at here with these tutorials. I'm going to zip down here to Biomate, because I've added some things into the main campaign and the generated campaigns. You will not find this tutorial in an existing campaign because it's just been added into this station. If you so prefer, you can either generate a new galaxy or a new campaign and import your pilot, or you can just manually edit your sector or station zero, sector zero file in your stations folder of your save game and add in the line of code into the offices that will allow you to preview this new tutorial that I've added in. And what this tutorial is doing is just basically giving you a simple walkthrough of how the wormholes work, and kind of following in suit with the previous update and the addition of these technical documents that are now being accessible from the ship journal. So you can see down here we've got a tutorial for wormhole basics, and you can go through this tutorial and it'll explain all of the ins and outs of how wormholes work. And once you kind of go through all of this stuff, you can get to the end, and then he will give you the document, just like the fleet mercenaries worked. So if you jump into your journal here, you can go into the documents, and you'll take a look, and you'll see that you've got some wormhole stuff here, and then you have access to all of that information whenever you need. All right, so how do these wormholes work? So what is happening now is the background event generator is going to go through and roll dice to give you a chance that a wormhole could spawn in any given sector. Now, there is no limitations to the number of wormholes that can spawn. You could have an active game with literally hundreds of wormholes hiding out there. But the way that I did it, as to not bloat your save game or have the generator run away from you, is that what the actual generator is doing is simply creating a door to a wormhole that does not exist yet. And then only when you attempt to pass through that door does it actually generate the wormhole. It literally does it as you're warping through the wormhole gate. It generates that map, and that map is then put into your save game file, and then you can consistently and continuously access that map in your save game. Now, the wormholes are generated, so it's almost like a little mini sandbox map being created inside of the game itself, or in your save game. And when this occurs, there will be news events telling you what sector or regions, in some cases, where these wormholes are suspected to be generated. And after reading through the wormhole tutorials in the document, you will understand that, you know, there is these energy anomalies that cause these wormholes to appear. So what you're able to do is kind of keep an eye on the news to see if you see any of these wormholes spawning about, and then trying to find that location, because in some instances it's going to be a location you haven't explored yet and you don't know where it is. However, once they've spawned in that location, they will not despawn until you've collapsed the gate manually. Now, I may change that in the future. I may add a few events that go through and despawn very old unexplored wormholes or the doorways to those wormholes, because again, it doesn't actually generate the map until you pass through it. So, but for now, those wormholes will remain persistent and you'll be able to access that at a much later time. So it's not a bad idea to make note and keep an idea where those wormhole energy signatures have been detected. All right, so it just so happens that in my test map right here, I happen to have a wormhole. But before I do that, I need to install something here so that you can see how this works. I do believe I have a active scanner in here somewhere. Yep, there it is. All right, so let's get rid of that, and we'll throw on our generic active scanner, and we'll pop that down there, and let's undock. All right, so when you are in a system that has a wormhole, but you have not explored that wormhole yet, you will not see it in your tactical sensors. It will not show up anywhere. Now, there is a slight and small effect to the wormhole so that you can see it with the naked eye, although the effect is very small and it will not be easy to spot in some of these sectors that have lots of particles and little things here and there. So what you're going to want to do is activate your active scanner. And every time the active scanner cycles, it'll give you a report about whatever it is you're scanning. So let's just say, for example, I'm going to switch my target over here to this energy generator. And as that active scanner goes through and scans the energy generator, well, I might want to target it, then it'll give me a report. But it will also give me some information about any wormholes in that particular area. So as you can see, this active scanner is wrapping up here, and then once it completes, it gives me my normal report, but it's also telling me that a wormhole has been detected, and it's 653 meters away. So I can kind of fly around in different directions and try to figure out or pinpoint the location of an unseen wormhole just by using my active scanner. However, there's another little feature of the active scanner. I'm going to go ahead and disable my autopilot and just make sure I fly within 500 meters of this wormhole. And let's turn that off. And let's turn off our afterburners because I don't want to get away too far. And let's go. Yep. Okay. So we're still within range here. And I'm going to activate the active scanner again. And if by chance I had not scanned this wormhole, it wouldn't be showing up on the map, and it definitely wouldn't be showing up in my tactical sensors. But I've already scanned it for purposes of this video, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to remove it from my targeting. And not only am I going to remove it from my targeting, but I'm also going to remove it from my scanned list. So now that guy is technically invisible. You know, it would technically be invisible, even though it's still showing up because I already had it scanned. But notice this. As soon as that finished, that it finished scanning, it actually selected the wormhole. So for those wormholes that you cannot see and you have not scanned, if you're close enough, it will automatically scan the wormhole for you and add it to the list, thus adding it to the pre-scanned list, thus always making that wormhole visible to you in tactical mode. And even, well, you're not going to see it too much because there's not really a thing there to see, but it'll be in your scanned list, so you'll be good to go. Let's go ahead and turn off that active scanner there. All right, so now you'll notice that this wormhole is available right here. It's showing that there is enough energy in this wormhole for 4 more jumps through this gate. Now, each gate, the entry and exit, have their own energy counts, so it is possible to collapse one end of the wormhole while the other end is still open. Now, once you've gone to the wormhole, that map will exist, and it will also show up as it does here, right there. Nope, that's not the one. It's this one down here. It'll show up on that list, and then you'll be able to access that even using warp drives. So you do not need the warp gates to get to a wormhole sector. If you look over on the mouse over tooltip, you can see that the wormhole security can get very low. And also some of the life supports can get very dangerous as well. So that's just something to kind of keep in mind when you're traveling to these. The raiders and the baddies that you'll be fighting there will be very, very tough to beat. All right, so we're going to go ahead and warp through this wormhole here. And I'm going to show you what is on the other side. Now, this particular wormhole, I do believe, is a hideout. Yes, that is correct. So what has happened here is it has generated a hideout with these structures and these defensive missile platforms or gun platforms around here. One thing to note, I have made some changes to the way that the structure AI works together with other structures. So if, for example, I decide to attack one of these structures, then that defensive gun platform will alert all of these other structures and they will all begin firing on me. So it's not just because that guy took a hit, he's going to alert all of the other structures in that region. I've also made some changes to the ability to dock at raider structures, so no longer is that a thing for now, and it may change a little bit in the future, but for right now it's going to stay this way. And because the raider structures are already hostile, it is not required that you put friendly fire or anything like that to activate, your modules to attack that structure. However, when you would get too close, if you had auto dock on, you would end up docking with it, which was just very counterintuitive and really didn't make very much sense. So I went ahead and changed that and I fixed that, and that is no longer an issue. All right, you may notice here that it's not very easy to see the warp gates or the wormholes. So if you come into a wormhole sector and you immediately do not lock that gate, it is very possible that you get lost for a little while. And if you're stuck out here with raiders, that can be a massive problem. So make sure you know where your wormholes are or you will get stuck. It just so happens that I've already been back and forth, so I can just go to the galaxy map and click my way back, and it will automatically find where that gate is and take me where I need to go. So you can see it's taking me to the gate over there. But it's just something to keep in mind, because you will get stuck and you will get lost out here if you're not paying attention to those wormhole gates. All right, so as you jump back and forth through these wormholes, then what is happening is it's depleting the energy. And as the energy depletes all the way, the wormhole, or the gate for that wormhole, will collapse. Now, that doesn't mean the wormhole will not open back up. The gate will still exist. It will just be inaccessible. So you can see right here, these jumps are numbered at 3. Well, I didn't want to have to wait forever. I think it's upwards of 15 to 20 minutes in some cases for the generator to suck together enough energy to give me one more jump back into a wormhole. So what I've done is I have placed a public energy generator very close to the wormhole. You can see I have it within the radius of its power ability. And this wormhole will begin to leech energy from the energy generator, and it will charge up twice as fast. So the more energy generators you put around a wormhole, the more number of jumps you're going to be able to charge up. And what that'll do is just make it very easy for you to get back and forth until eventually you have the ability to build a warp gate over top of the wormhole that will become yours. You'll be able to set tolls and things, which will be a passive money income or credit income. You'll be able to kind of manage these warp gates that go to these various wormhole sectors. So technically you could own hundreds of gates to hundreds of wormholes and sit back and collect money from the NPCs that are going back and forth through them. The downside is once you build a warp gate, well, then now everybody knows it's there and you won't be alone in your little paradise anymore. You'll have other people out there mining your rocks and doing things that you might not want them to do. So building a warp gate on a wormhole has its benefits when it comes to, you know, having to deal with the energy charging. But if you're getting really high level, you probably won't be using the gates too much and you'll just be warping directly to the individual sectors. All right, so as these gates begin to collapse, after you've depleted all the jumps and they collapse, it'll take a while for them to recharge. You can pop out an energy generator to help them charge a little bit faster, and these are stackable. So it's not something that building multiple energy generators would be a waste. It actually will make it charge up quite quickly. I'm sure if you built 3 or 4, even 5 energy generators around the wormhole, that sucker would charge up really fast and you'd have pretty much unlimited jumps all you want without any issue. All right, so on the inside of these wormholes, there are different factors and different things that can occur. You can find wormholes that are very safe and very moderate temperature and climate and full of resources, a great place to build a little base or a mining operation. And then you can also find wormholes that are loot areas that have all kinds of crates to collect, and lots of special items are generated for these crates. The only downside is when a crate is sucked through a wormhole, it breaks its seal, so you're not going to have much time to get in there and steal those crates. Once the crates are stolen, they will not regenerate again. You will not get them back again. However, I have added in a new feature or some new functionality to the game that is persistent crates. So now if you are out in the game and you, let's say, kill a raider and then you leave that map, that raider stuff is still sitting there in the crate. And when you return, it'll still be there. So there's the addition of the crates, or the persistent crates, should make for a lot more usability, especially when going back and forth through these wormholes. Now, the timers on those crates will not expire while you're not in the sector. It was something I had set initially, and it really just kind of sucked because it pretty much limited you, with some of these timers being no more than 5 minutes. Heading to a station and resupplying or dropping off some goods pretty much wiped out the rest of the crates. And however realistic that might seem, it just wasn't very fun. So I'm going to leave it so that the crates only deteriorate, their timers only deteriorate when the map is loaded and not when you're outside of that sector. So that part is not persistent. They're not going to all disappear on you because they ran out of juice. Okay, so one of the other major things here, you know what, I do not want to dock there, is, let's go through here, let's go look at something different. I did make a number of changes to some of the texture props and some things like that to really try to increase some of the quality of the backgrounds and visuals. It's something I've been working on for quite some time, and little by little it's just starting to improve. So you can see I've got a lot better textures on some of these background rocks. This one I was able to get the normal maps to line up much better and more with the UV-free texturing, where it's not using any of the meshes UV. All right, so one of the other little tweaks that I've done is having to do with these modules down here. So you'll notice that all of those little buttons have disappeared. And what happened was I was playing around and I wanted to add in some more buttons, and after I did it, it just looked horrible. And in an effort to try to make it look less horrible than the little floaty circle buttons that were already over here, I ended up just making it worse. And I got quite frustrated. I walked away, I took a break, and I brainstormed, and I came up with this idea. So now you just move the mouse to the bottom of the screen, and now these little quick buttons will pop up. So you're still getting your open all panels, close all panels, but now you've got these new 6 buttons, and I will be adding more into here for a few other things. And then over here with the module buttons, I was thinking about including some ship functionality, like just quick buttons for the autopilot stuff, for toggling autopilot, toggling your afterburners, opening your ship stats, opening your journal, opening your missions panel, little things like that. But you can see right here, you can now open the stats panel, the cargo, GPS, all of the panels can be open and closed and toggled from this little quick menu. And then as soon as you mouse off of it, it just disappears. And I definitely like this system a lot better. It's not 100% solid the way that it's going to work, and I will probably be improving and you know, making it a little bit more usable and less cluttery. But for now, I am absolutely much happier with this than I was with those little circle buttons over here, because it was very limited. I could basically get 4 or 5 or 6 buttons, and then after that it just looked like a big hot mess of shit. So that's gone, and I definitely like this system a lot better now. All right, guys, I think for the most part that covers everything that I wanted to talk about in this video. Over these next couple weeks, I'm going to be finishing up some of the structure stuff, tying in with some of the Merc functionality, and then finishing off some of the stuff for structures dealing with the wormholes. And then we are really starting to shape up and look good for some good juicy content coming this summer. So I think we're on track. I know you guys have been asking me for a roadmap, and I swear at some point I'm going to sit down and really try to make a roadmap that I can stick to. But the problem is just, you know, it just doesn't want to stick in my head that way. And other things crop up, bugs pop up, issues with functioning mechanics and other things that just aren't quite the way that they should be seem to take priority and precedent. And it just feels like the roadmap, I end up wasting my time trying to design a solid roadmap that almost gets abandoned after I make it about 20% down the path. So I've done this a few times. I've never released one online because of that. And the closest thing to any kind of roadmap would be what I am explaining I want to have in the game when I release it from early access is right there on the store page for Steam and on GOG. So hopefully that'll hold you guys over enough. I'm always willing to talk and discuss about this stuff, so you can always hit me up, whether it's email on the forums or on the Discord channel. So I'm open to discussion about it, but I just don't want to waste too much time, you know, trying to formulate a master plan that ends up falling apart rather quickly because something else cool came along and is going to take priority over whatever I was planning to do that week. All right. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, make sure you hit that like button. And if you're new here, go ahead and subscribe. I will do my best to hop back on the forums and stuff now that I got these wormholes working. I've been kind of hiding in my box because I can easily get distracted on the Discord channel chatting about all kinds of nonsense. But I think I'm pretty solid now. I've made some major surgery here, and I just didn't want to get distracted enough to break anything. So even though I've been popping in here and there, I'll be able to spend some more time on there and you guys be able to chat if you want. I do have a few more videos coming out. I plan on doing a new promo trailer, actually two, one short 1 minute quick video trailer with all of the new graphics, all of the new functionality showing the actual UI where we're at 100 builds later. And then I'm going to do another promo video that'll be about as long as a devlog that has commentary and me explaining all kinds of stuff about the game to as if I were talking to someone who was thinking about purchasing it and just trying to explain to them what my vision for this game is, what Astrox is, and then, and more importantly, what Astrox isn't. Because the worst thing is having someone's expectations be at a particular area only to discover this game is not the droids they were looking for. And, you know, sometimes that's heartbreaking, and especially if you spent money on it, then you feel like you got gypped or you cheated or, you know, scammed in some way, shape, or form. And to eliminate that, I think if I just take some time and explain what's going on here and what I'm trying to accomplish, it might eliminate some of that stuff. All right, guys. Well, I think that's about it. And until next time, this is Momo Guru signing out.